There are multiple win conditions in Battlegrounds, and to get to the point, I'm going to make a quick overview of each and every single one of them. I'm going to talk about their pros, their cons, and how to make them work. This is going to be a long video, so let's just get to it. Starting with Beast, we got Leapfrogger. Leapfrogger is one of the earliest win conditions in the game, but comes at the price of being difficult to set up. While you may find key cards like Monstrous Macaw, Rat Pack, and Sewer Rat in the early tiers, Baron Rivendare is the only way to make it all work. Without Baron, there's little chance of you beating other builds. To further make it difficult, you're expected to taunt two minions, reborn three of them, and you need extra stats so you don't lose to tech cards. However, once you get the build going, it's really hard to defeat this build. Mama Bear is perhaps one of the best win condition cards in the game. She instantly gives you a lot of stats to any piece that you play, allowing you to have a strong early advantage over most builds. While you may win the early to mid game easily, the late game becomes a little bit more challenging. Assuming you never get another win condition like Goldrin or Leapfrogger, you need to start making triples of the beast that you're buffing. When you do, then you have a chance to compete against other builds with higher stats. Since you will be spawning a lot of minions, this comes with its own benefits and downsides. Since you will be spawning a lot of minions, it can easily overwhelm builds with low amounts of health, such as poison builds. However, if the hits go wrong, you might not summon all of your death rattles. Most builds require you to buy numerous amounts of cards to scale infinitely, like Nagas, Pirates, or Dragons. While Goldrin build doesn't have infinite scaling, their beast can gain a good amount of stats with a combination of Monstrous Macaw and Baron Rivendare. They'll easily be able to defeat the other builds before they hit 100-100 in stats. The downside is, to compete against those infinite stat builds, you're going to need multiple triples, reborns, and extra stats to defeat them. While Mama Bear is an easy to lean towards build due to her strong tempo, Goldrin requires much more setup. He isn't very strong tempo wise unless you already have Beast in play. Next up are Elementals. Dazzling Light Spawn used to be one of the strongest and earliest win conditions, but if the meta is not in favor of Avenge, it could be very weak. If you get Light Spawn early enough, you can buff your Elementals without having to spend too much gold. More than usual, you definitely need to triple your elementals to combine all of the stats so you can compete against the stronger builds in the game. Go for this as a win condition if you manage to get it early enough, anytime before turn 8, and if you got a good amount of death rattles and health. Also keep the option open to transitioning to Famished Feltbat if you can. So first off, this build really doesn't hit its high point without recycling rate. Second, your build is really awkward since you got 1 minion you're buffing, recycling rate, 2 major domos, 1 or 2 master realities, and 1 free slot you need to use to recycle elementals. Unfortunately, tripling the major domos means master realities has less buffs gained overall, and tripling the master realities makes it more susceptible to poisons or Leroy. You can mitigate this by having another taunt, but usually isn't worth it. But if you're stuck trying to scramble for a build, this one can still work out if you play it right. Eventually, stats won't matter a lot due to poisons or Leroy, so don't forget to replace your major domos for the last fight with something like Selfless Hero. If you got the right cards like Recycling Wraith, Silimentals, and a hero power that can help you with Nomi build like Zorella, Hooktas, Galawix, Vol'jin, then Nomi can go incredibly well. You're constantly buying and selling elementals. Since these elementals initially start out weak, it's going to take a while for you to be strong. It's why you need to find Nomi so early to function properly. The previously mentioned heroes are the best at him because they can easily find elementals or mitigate the initial weak tempo from doing this build. Just like the light spawn build, you definitely want to triple your minions so you can stack up the stats. Be sure to also have the best elementals so you don't lose to builds with poison. Lil Rag is pretty bad. So you need Lil Rag, possibly two, and possibly golden. Gentle Genie, Recycling Wraith, maybe even Brand to help out with extra scaling and extra elementals, and Guard for the finishing touches. But once you got it down, and you can have any minion in your build such as Foe Reaper and Deflectobot, it still is a bit underwhelming. Since the scaling isn't AoE, and until you have multiple lower rags, you're honestly not going to scale that fast compared to other builds. I really advise not to do this build unless you're really fortunate enough to get all these key cards. And even then, it's going to be a struggle. Peggy's kind of a win condition. It's never a card you seek to build around, but you can get a solid foundation with Peggy. There has been games where I had two Peggies buffing one another, and they match the scale up pretty well. Without Hogger, sadly, they become worse as the buff becomes more spread out and not as effective. If you can't find any other cards to revolve your build around, then make sure Peggy's only buffing 1 to 2 pirates. Probably people's most favorite win condition, Captain Hogar is the backbone of APM Pirates. By constantly buying pirates, you can easily see your board with 200-200 stats. However, that comes at a cost. You do need multiple Captain Hogarths to be infinite, not just one golden, but probably a fourth Hogarth so you can go true infinite. As well, you need to have the knowledge to know what to do. Recognize every pirate card, know which non-pirate card to look out for, know which card to buff with South Sea Strong Arm, and know how to properly position your build against upcoming opponents. If you can get all that done, you'll be nearly unstoppable. But remember, Hogar is really weak early on. He needs to be golden, and you need Peggy or Salty Looter to really get yourself to be high statted. Aliza is probably the best tier 6 in terms of instant tempo. While some tier 6 minions don't give you immediate power until you have certain cards, Aliza will already give you a board wide buff once she or any of other pirates attack. But until you have Scallywags, Golden Khadgar, and Golden Baron, you're not going to beat the high-statted builds. Zap is also still a major weakness, until you buff Khadgar and Baron Rivendare. You also need to watch out for small taunts as they can prevent Scallywags' death rattle. Luckily, the build has multiple variations, so you could still do successfully well even if you don't have the right key cards. Okay, now at Demons. Impulse the Trickster can be the most important cards for certain builds if you can get the right tribes. Beast, Dragons, and Quillboards really help this card become a real win condition. However, Murlocs kinda make this card obsolete at times. Poisons really easily counter this build and makes all the health gain completely pointless. Really, only go to this build if you realistically can buff this minion stats and that there's no Murlocs to ruin your day. Pyramid, for example, is probably the best user for this card. Wrathweaver is one of the earliest win conditions you can get in this game, but he falls under multiple problems. He solely cannot win you the game. You may be able to use his tempo to find other win conditions, but you still have to consider all the health you will lose on the way. It's best not to think this card as the key to your victory, but as a card that will help you win the early to mid game so you can actually find a real win condition. Soul Juggler is very oppressive in its ability to deal indirect damage. However, that comes at the cost of losing to builds that scale in stats and being unable to scale yourself. There are some builds that do lose to Soul Juggler, however. Builds that don't start with lots of health, such as Mechs and Beast, they can really see their composition crumble under each shot. Generally speaking, it's rare to get first place with Soul Juggler, so be ready to transition to another build entirely. Famished Velbat is a very powerful card due to just how fast your demons can scale without you needing to spend gold. The catch, however, is that all the downsides I listed. Poison hurts your build, most minion stats are not that big, so you need elementals to really scale high, and since you scale off Bob's board, you may not be able to get the cards you want when you freeze the board. Still, that shouldn't sway you away from this card. All of those downsides have ways to play around it. You can still gain Divine Shield or fight back against Poison with some of your own. You can gain big stats through other tribe cards or even use Uther. And freezing does get worse, but there's not really much you can do about that. But it's great if you're Sindragosa. Okay, dragons. Terragosa and Prize Promogic scale incredibly fast, but only if you can find the right cards. It's easy for someone like Ysera, Cookie, Galewing, or Silas to find these cards, since they have ways with their hero powers to look for them. But for most heroes, it's difficult to get these specific dragons. But once you get going, it's really hard for your opponent to outscale your Terragosas. Then once you got Nidina, you can guarantee to get first place. Just watch out for Leroy's. Talagos is incredibly slow to scale. While other builds give you passive scaling where you don't need to spend much gold, Talagos needs you to specifically find battle cries for scaling, and just like any other build, you have to spend gold to buy the dragons as well. It's terribly slow, but there are ways to speed it up. Obviously, two or more Talagos speeds things up. Brand Bondsbeard in combination with cards like Tavern Tempest, Murzon, Primalfin, and Deep Sea Diver really help out. Lastly, Witchwing Nestmachin will really speed things up if you can get the right build going. Nidina is especially important for you to round out your build and give you an extra boost in strength. Sometimes you can live with just one Kalagos and Nidina, but you usually need other cards to help keep up with scaling, such as Razor Gore, Prize Promodrake, or Dragon Enforcer. On to mechs. There's multiple Omega Buster builds. With Macaw, you got a board that's full of stats similar to Golden Beast. With Kangors and Holy Mackerel, it becomes a build where you constantly get refreshes with Deflectobot. But with Tunnel Blaster, Kangors, and Baron, you can have an Exodia build. A very hard to defeat build that only needs a few key pieces. Of course, you still purchase an Uther so your minions don't get sniped. It's one of the strongest builds in the game, and there really isn't much you can do to stop it. But all of the builds have one thing in common. Omega Buster isn't really that strong by itself. You still need all the necessary pieces, so you may lose some fights until you got the right cards. Not as strong as it once was, but it's still an alright win condition. If you have Deflectobot or Holy Mackerel, this is great. Otherwise, you're better off finding something else. It's difficult to use effectively at first, since you may not have Divine Shields ready to scale. And even if you do, depending on which card it is, you may only gain stats once per combat. It's not the worst win condition, but it's definitely something that only works if you're ready to find it. Good old Deflectobot, one of the staple cards of mech. You can really use Deflectobot in many builds. Divine Shield builds, Omega Buster builds, Menagerie, and even the build that focuses on itself. Deflectobot is still pretty good because of all the attack it gains from spawning mechs, but also because of the refreshing Divine Shields. Now with cards like Iron Sensei back, you can really go far with just being a tier 4 and having your Deflectobots destroy your opponent's builds. However, you can still lose multiple times, so watch out for that. It is still better to look out for various builds that Deflectobot can fit into, but it's a build that you can still get top 4 with, so don't forget about it. Alright, Murlocs. Gigantic demons, they're dead. Gigantic elementals, they're gone. Gigantic pirates, rest in peace. Poison is one of the strongest keywords in the game. If you can get your minions to have large amounts of health, the Murlocs are pretty strong and hard to stop. But without it, you won't have enough health to compete properly. Sometimes you can get by with a soft scale honcho, but you really need a Brand Bondsbeard and a bunch of Battlecry Murlocs to properly round out the build. But even without those cards, you can still get far with just poison. Young Murkai, pretty strong once you have Bran, pretty slow when it's by itself. Normally Murlocs have a problem finding cards if you don't roll into them, so Young Murkai really helps out with that. But you can only really see its true potential once you have Bran, otherwise it's terribly weak. Alright, Quillbores. Groundshaker can easily give you the win even against builds with large amounts of health. If you can get an early gen splitter and you have mechs, elementals, or dragons in the game, then this is a build you should keep your eye on. It's something I like to do if I don't have enough time to level up to tier 5. But you do lose to Tunnel Blaster and Death Rattles with lots of tokens. Of course you can do Groundshaker with cards like Trogger or Dark Gaze, but this one's a little bit more consistent. Second Thorn Curse is one of the strongest win conditions in the game, while also being one of the most difficult to get right. Like Groundshaker, you can use Genslayer to generate Blood Gems, or you can use Dark Gaze Elder, or you can use Trogger but to lesser effect. With Genslayer, it's a little bit more simple. It comes with the same problems as Groundshaker, such as having a full hand and needing Divine Shield minions, but since a lot of the best tribes you're looking for are usually below tier 5, you should be fine. With Dark Gaze Elder, it's slightly different. You potentially can get more than you can get with Genslayer, but you need cards that can spend gold like Hogar or Bran. If you're in the lobby without that many Divine Shields, you have to use Dark Gaze Elder if you properly want to get them for Agum. Agum builds are going to start out really slow, but if you can get into the right position, you're going to be unstoppable. Chagra has a decent amount of immediate tempo due to giving your board a wild scale buff, but it's really slow. It's just 1-1 throughout the whole board, so unless you got special effects like Agum Agum or Dynamic Duo, you're not going to expect yourself to be outscaling anybody else. Honestly, I would only really pick up this card if the other choices don't help you out at all, or if you already got Quillbores on your board. Dark Gaze is similar to Chagra, except by spending gold, you can get multiple blood gems to 4 Quillbores. This is still really slow since you need to spend 5 gold, but once you got Hogar or Bran, then you will scale incredibly high. It's a good card for direction, but if you don't got the proper cards to go with Dark Gaze, it might not work out for you. Okay, last tribe, Nagas. Critter Wrangler is in an odd spot where she has to have subpar minions to generate spellcrafts, and she can't buff those minions. She can really only buff one, ideally something with cleave or something that can use up all those stats. And while that minion may be powerful, your build shows a glaring weakness if that minion goes down. So if your opponent can see your build coming, be sure to have a backup plan like Mantic Queen or Leroy's. Athissa is the go-to win condition for Nagas. Unlike Kalagos, spellcrafts come once per turn, so you don't need to constantly buy minions. Unfortunately, she only buffs up to 4 Nagas, meaning only 4 will be strong, or the scaling will be divided amongst the multiple Nagas. Some Nagas gain extra stats from having spellcrafts put onto them, but they don't generate any spellcrafts themselves. So you have to find the right balance between spellcraft Nagas and non-spellcraft Nagas. Still, with the built-in utility that Nagas have, Athissa remains one of the best win conditions in the game, but it really helps you to find spellcrafts on the way to getting her. Okay, the neutrals. Bran Bronzebeard is probably one of the most beloved cards in the game. He has seen highs and lows, but right now, he's a bit difficult. There are plenty of amazing battle crimes in the game for him to have, but that's usually when there's elementals or murlocs in the game. And sometimes pirates. The other battlecries in the other tribes tend not to be worth purchasing, even with Bran. So while Bran has lots of potential if you get the right battlecries, there sometimes are not enough battlecries for you to bring the best out of him. Lightfang Enforcer is really only good if you can get it early on with multiple tribes. In fact, that amount of stats could really help you out due to the immediate tempo. Sadly, the eventual stats gained won't keep up with the other tribes scaling faster. You're going to either need to change the build, or you're going to need to do something about the bigger minions such as using poisons or Leeroy. These two cards plus any other poisons will absolutely wreck any pure stats build, but that doesn't make it unbeatable. Death Rattle tokens, indirect damage, sometimes even divine shields and cleave can really stop them. They have low amounts of health and without any good way to properly scale. So while they destroy plenty of the late game builds, they could easily lose to certain mid game cards. Alright, so those were the win conditions, but let's quickly go through some cards that I really need to talk about. These are kind of win conditions, or they're either things I don't really have much to say about them because they support other builds. Razor Gore is a great find for any build that gets mostly dragons. If you're already dragons, then it's perfect for immediate tempo. If you're not, then don't force it to go dragons unless you got other forms of scaling. Bird Buddy has an incredible amount of tempo and can honestly win you a lot of games if you got the right amount of death rattles or reborns. You will probably win the mid game a lot of the times. However, you are probably not going to win the whole game just through Bird's Buddy strength. It's not quite a win condition, but it's good direction to make you feel safe while looking for one. Similar to Bird Buddy, but Palescale Crocolis is slightly better. The amount of tempo is crazy good, but like Bird Buddy, you aren't going to win with just this card being your main form of stats. You're going to need this to be paired up with the other previously mentioned beast. Big stats and that's it. You aren't going to win the game with Gar as your win condition, since he only increases his health, and he's really weak to poisons and Leeroy. He's okay tempo if you can have his stats immediately, but otherwise he is a really bad card until you got the other elemental win conditions. Mithrax falls under the same problem as Razor Gore, except he doesn't have Nadina to back him up. It's big stats, great tempo, but you won't win the game solely because of him. The worst part about him is, if you want to do menagerie with him, you don't have enough room with Lightfang or Bran. Tony Two Tusks just enhances the other pirates' win conditions. However, he also makes Gold Grubber into a win condition. Sometimes Tony is fine to triple into just because of how strong Avenge is early on, but it's only really Hogar, Nosy Looter, Aliza, Gold Grubber, and Peggy that benefits greatly from being golden. I'll pick him up if I can realistically see the Avenge proccing on one of those aforementioned pirates. Baron Rivendare of course is a powerful win condition, but only for the previously mentioned win conditions like Goldrin, Leapfrogger, and Omega Buster. So anything I say for Baron is kind of redundant. Try not to get sniped by Zap, try to find these cards, and that's really it. Sometimes you're lucky to triple into him and find those cards soon after, but it may not happen, and the other death rattles in this game won't lead you into victory when you put him with Baron. Mechano Tank works identically to Soul Juggler. It loses to big stats, but strong against certain builds. Sometimes you can get top 4 with a build focusing on Mechano Tank, but it's rare. Holy Mackerel can be seen as a win condition due to the built-in RNG ping pong it can provide, as well as the constant refreshes. Sadly, it can't scale by itself. Most likely you'll be outscaled unless you got Greasebot, Arm of the Empire, or Gen Splitter. There are still major issues to consider such as Windfury and Leeroy. And finally, Arm of the Empire. Arm of the Empire is very rare to be a win condition nowadays. She can buff taunts, ideally those with Divine Shield, and that's really it. You can catch some people off guard with your high amounts of attack, but if they got Leeroy, indirect damage, death rattles, or large stats, then you're not going to do well with her. But get her in the right build, such as mechs, then you can really get top 4 with her. Alright, and that's all the win conditions. That was a very long video, I hope this helps out. If they update anything in the future, like add new cards, I may make a video on those. Thank you all for watching. Please give the video a like and subscribe to my channel. If you're interested in coaching, just for $12 an hour, I can coach you on anything you need to know about Battlegrounds through Medify and WeCoach. And also, if you like my videos, please consider donating to my Ko-fi so I can keep making them. See you all next time. I hope to see you all climb. And thank you all so much.